Indeed.
Wonderful to see all of you here today. Just as for your information, our wonderful property committee is working on the heating system. And so thank you for bringing your warmth to quite us nice and toasty here today. Just want to say briefly that our secretary, Susie, who had a knee operation a little over a week ago, developed some issues and is back in the hospital at St. Peter's. So keep her in your prayers. She loves phone calls. She can have visitors if you are up in the Olympia area, but we definitely want to keep Susie in our prayers. And a big thank you to Carol for stepping up to take care of the secretarial duties. So thank you very much, and we'll continue to keep her in our prayers. We are going to continue our worship now on page 94 with the order for confession and forgiveness. Page 94. We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And now we take a moment to reflect on our lives and our need for God's healing forgiveness and love. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to us the entire forgiveness of all our sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. The theme for the worship today is the key ingredients for good relationships. So, once again, I will invite you at the time of the message to share your insights about what you feel are the key ingredients for good relationships. So I invite us to share our opening hymn, number 666, What Wondrous Love Is It? Stand as you are able.
Right.
which we will all pray together as one. Almighty God,
your Son came into the world to free us from sin and death. Bring them upon the power of your Spirit, that we may be raised to new life in Christ, and serve you in righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated. Harry Kistler shares the reading of today's scriptures, and all of the messages, the message will be on all of the scripture readings today. So let's pay attention to Harry.
Hopefully you'll cut me a bit of slack because I can't see very well. The Old Testament reading for today is Ezekiel chapter 37, verses 1 through 14, the Valley of Dry Bones. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said, "Sovereign Lord, you alone know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound. And the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked and tendons and flesh appeared on them and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the Sovereign Lord says. Come, breath, from the four winds, and breathe into these slain that they may live.' So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, 'Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the Sovereign Lord says. My people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord, when I open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm today is Psalm 130, and let's read it responsively. A song of ascents. Out of the depths I cry to you, Lord. Lord, hear my voice.
Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If you were to keep watch over the sins, Lord, who could stand?
Okay, I have a different one. Yet with you is forgiveness, in order that you may be feared.
I will wait for you, O Lord. My soul waits in your word and my hope.
My soul waits for the Lord more than those who keep watch for the morning.
More than those who keep watch for the morning.
O Israel, wait for the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love.
With the Lord there is plenteous redemptions. For the Lord is redeeming Israel from all their sins.
And the epistle reading for today is from Romans chapter 8, verses 6 through 11. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his Spirit who lives in you. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Jerry.
You're welcome.
Excellent job.
Thank you.
Excellent. Well, this morning we have the longest gospel reading of the whole year. So I'm not going to have you stand.
Good.
You may sit and listen to this long story of John chapter 11. Now, a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble because the light is not in them." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he's fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death. But they thought he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now, Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." The dead man came out, his hands and feet. When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." Don't want to leave that part out. "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We continue now with the hymn of the day, and I invite us to stand for the hymn of the day. It is 333. Jesus is a rock and a weary limb. Please be seated. I thank you for those who knew that hymn. It's the first time I've ever sung it. Great hymn, great words, great message in that hymn. Well, dear friends, grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ.
Amen.
Well, I invited us to think about what the key ingredients are to have a good relationship. And I'd like to hear what you think. What are your thoughts about the main characteristics or qualities, things that we do to promote good relationships? Colleen.
Open and honest communication.
Beautiful. Beautiful. And that's not always easy.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's difficult for being open and honest about things. So that is a beautiful way to start. Open and honest communication. Excellent. Other people who would share what promotes, develops good relationships. Who else would share today?
A good listener.
A good listener. That shows that you care. You care about the person and you care about what's important to them. A good listener. So, husbands, let's pay note of that. Thank you very much. Oh, Gary, we've got time after church. I'll
respect for the other person.
Respect for the other person. Absolutely. Yes. Did I see a hand? I've got several here. Candy and Terry.
Love for your neighbor.
Love for your neighbor. Oh, yes. Yes. And that means active love. Caring about them. Checking in on them. Seeing how they're doing. Absolutely. Terry, over here.
You need a sense of humor, especially to be able to laugh at yourself.
Beautiful. Not to take ourselves too seriously. I think that's wonderful. Pastor Matt.
Regular showers.
Regular showers! Now I know my problem. Thank you, Pastor Matt. Did I see one over here? Did I see another one? Anybody? Over here, Rossi.
I think trust is very important.
Trust. Absolutely. Trust. And it's very damaging when the trust is broken. So trust, developing trust, that's huge because it lets us open up. Over here, I think that's Arda.
Do not expect perfection.
Yes. Yes.
No one is perfect.
No one is perfect.
Don't expect it.
Another reason why I love the ELCA. We are all about grace and maybe a little gray. So thank you for that. Excellent, excellent answers. Well, in the midst of your answers, there's a theme that I heard, and that's to be devoted to the person. To realize that person matters to you enough that you're going to be devoted to them. You're going to pay attention to them, as you said, being a good listener and trust and honest and those things. Well, that is the way God is with us. God is devoted to us. So much so that he would send his only son, Jesus, to connect with us. And I love this theme of God devoted to us in the Old Testament lesson. There was a song that came out in the 50s by a black male gospel group. You remember that song? The hip bone's connected to the knee bone. The knee bone's connected to the shin bone. Remember that song?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Well, that song was based on today's Old Testament lesson. That's where they got that from. Now, was there literally a valley of dry bones? Or were the people of Israel so distraught and so discouraged and so lifeless that they felt that way? That they felt like there was no reason for them to live anymore? And God is aware of that. And so he says, what do we do? What do we do? How about these valley of dry bones? Can we breathe life into them? And I love when God breathes life into them, the bones start to rattle. Isn't that neat? The bones start to rattle, and there starts to be sinew and cartilage and tendons and muscles, and they come alive. How did that happen? Because God breathed his spirit. God was devoted to his people, his chosen people, enough to not leave them in the valley as dry bones,
but to bring them back to life, to revive them, to restore them. And that's what God does to us. You know, I hear so much about people talking about how bad COVID was. And sure, it was bad. Maybe you lost a loved one, or maybe you got sick from the COVID. And sure, it was a bad thing. But God's still on the job. God does not take a day off. And he cares, and he wants to revive his people so that we do not feel like a valley of dry bones. Now, the psalm talks about God being devoted to us as well. The psalm talks about, even though we sin, I think somebody talked about perfection, was that you, Gabby? Somebody talked about God still loves us, even though we sin. We're not perfect. And thank goodness for that. You know, there's a religion here in America, I don't say the name, I want to respect them, but when someone rebels or is defiant, they have this practice called shunning. I think some of you might know from parents disciplining you, the silent treatment, where somebody does something that upsets you and you ignore them. That's the opposite of devoting yourself to them. Well, God doesn't do that. He reaches out to us. He is devoted to us. He cares about us. When we hurt, he hurts. Or she hurts. Whatever you want to decide God's gender is. God cares. God is devoted to us. In spite of our not being perfect, God is devoted to us. Now that leads to the epistle reading from Romans. And at the time of this church being started, Rome was probably the most metropolitan, the biggest city in the greater Mediterranean era. And there were many different things that people devoted themselves to that were not always God. And so Paul gets this church in Rome started, and he realizes that they need to be devoted to him so that they can be a light to a place of darkness, so that they can be a light, a theme and picture of hope, so that those who are in darkness but maybe hungering for the light can see the light and be brought into the light. And so Paul is saying to those people, God is devoted to you. You need to be devoted to him and let your light shine. Like our mission statement, shining God's light in love and service. And that's such a great mission statement. And that's a theme that should be for every church everywhere. Realizing that God is devoted to us and letting that light given to us shine in us and through us so that the world does not have to live in darkness. Which brings us to the longest gospel in the whole year. Now, the context of this gospel reading is very, very important. At this time, there were two different groups regarding Jesus. There was one group who was madder than heck at Jesus, and at the end of chapter 10, they wanted to stone Jesus. They wanted to put an end to Jesus. But there was another group that thought, this Jesus is he's a son of God. He's got something going on. He's doing God's ministry in our very midst. Well, because things were kind of tense, the disciples and Jesus, they get out of town for a couple days. They go to the place where John the Baptist had been doing baptizing. And the people there were very warm. They were very receptive and accepting of Jesus and very appreciative of his presence and ministry. Well, while Jesus is there, as we've heard in the gospel, Martha and Mary send a message to Jesus. And what was that message about?
Lazarus.
A sense of urgency. Now, they knew Jesus well enough that if they sent that message to him, Jesus would do something about it. They say, Lazarus, whom you love, your brother, is ill. They know Jesus is devoted to them. They know he cares. But when Jesus gets that message, what is his immediate response? He waits 2 days, but he explains why. He explains that I have waited these 2 days so that when I go to Bethany, you're going to see the glory of God revealed in me.
so you will know who I am. Well, those disciples, and we love the disciples, we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the disciples. Those disciples are kind of thinking, you know, what's going on here? And so Jesus goes ahead and explains to them, you know, Lazarus has fallen asleep. And they go, whew, well, if he's fallen asleep, it's no big deal. Well, that was a metaphor. Lazarus was actually dead. And after 2 days, Jesus says, but we are going to go there and you're going to see the glory of God revealed. So they go there, and if you do the math, 2 days before he leaves, another 2 days journey to get to Bethany, he's been dead for a while. As we heard, he's been in the tomb for 4 days. And when he arrives, who rushes out to greet him? Who rushes out to greet him? Martha first. Martha first. And we can sure appreciate what she says to Jesus. Lord, if you'd been here, if you'd only been here, Lord, this wouldn't have happened. Our brother, whom you love, he'd still be alive if you'd been here. But Jesus knows what he's doing. He knows why he intentionally waited those 2 days. And he talks about, do you believe in the Son of Man? Do you believe in the resurrection? And she says, well, I know he'll be raised at the resurrection. I know he'll be raised in the last days. No, 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 no. Do you believe in the resurrection now? I am the resurrection and the life. Jesus gives life. And that's something that's very important for us to remember. Jesus gives life. Your brother is going to rise again. And she says, yes, Lord, I believe. Probably a momentary exhilaration of her faith. And so she goes and tells Martha, Mary, her sister, she's pretty excited, you know, the Lord's come here, something's going to happen. God's devoted to us, something's going to happen. Well, Mary goes out and the same thing. Wow, Lord, if you'd only been here, our brother would not have died. And Jesus doesn't pursue a conversation with Mary like he did with Martha, but he says, take me to where you have buried him. And the Jews there are consoling Mary. They're probably weeping with her. And we have verse 35, the shortest passage in the whole Bible. Jesus wept. And we don't know for sure what Jesus wept means. Why did he weep? We don't know for sure. I tend to believe that Jesus wept because the people did not yet fully understand who he was. That's what I believe. Now, maybe that's not true, but that's what I believe. That he wanted them to know the joy and hope and possibility that exists in a relationship with Jesus and how focused and devoted God is to us. So they take Jesus to where he is buried. He instructs them to roll away the stone. We know the story. I left that part out. Lazarus, come out! And what happens?
Comes out.
Lazarus comes out. And that explains why Jesus waited 2 days. You know, it's kind of a head scratcher. You know, why didn't Jesus go right away? That would have seemed to make more sense. But he waited those 2 days so he could show God at work in his life and an even greater miracle, that he can give life, that he can bring a person back to life from the dead. That is why he waited to do that, so people would know the magnitude of God in Jesus, his son. In the Gospel of John, we have about 6 or 7 miracles, and the miracles start out with, you know, not a real big deal, but each one progresses to a greater work of God, climaxing with the raising of Lazarus. The first one is Jesus turning water into wine. That doesn't compare with bringing a person to life out of the tomb. And the purpose in that is so that we can see, as we read this gospel and as we experience what God is doing, that in Jesus, God is devoted to us. And that's why Jesus is so important to us. That's why we need Jesus. Because we have times of despair. We have times of discouragement. I was talking with Susie on Friday and Saturday, and
It's a tough time for her. And I can relate to that after my knee surgery. It was about 3 days when I was pretty discouraged. If you doubt it, talk to my wife. I was pretty discouraged. So the physical therapist said, well, there's hope for you. And it was interesting because I had talked to Susie yesterday afternoon, and boy, she was low. And later last night, I accidentally hit her number when I was trying to reach my wife. And Susie called me back. It was late at night. And she sounded so much better. There was joy and hope in her voice because God is devoted to her. When I was in college, I had a roommate who, when he got a new girlfriend, he was totally locked in on that girlfriend. He would go and visit her every day for like a week. And then all of a sudden, he'd drop her like a bad burrito. And about a week after one of those girlfriends hadn't seen Dave for a week, she called up the apartment. I happened to be there. Dave was out with a new girlfriend. And she goes, what happened to Dave? How come he isn't here? Well, he was here because he was devoted to you for a season, but not forever. But God's devoted to us forever. And in Jesus Christ, nothing can take that away. Amen.
Amen.
And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, may it keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life eternal. Amen.
Amen.
I invite us once again to stand, and I've encouraged us to say the Apostles' Creed. I think I get some of the words mixed up, but, you know, my heart's in the right place. And if you'd like to do it by heart, I encourage that, because it's kind of handy to know by heart what the basis of our faith is, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born under the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. We continue now with the prayers and intercession. And if you have a prayer that you'd like to bring, either silently or out loud, we invite you to do that. Let us pray. Sustained by God's abundant mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all of creation. We pray for your church. Bless partnerships with other Christians and inter-religious dialogue. Guide the daily work of denominational and congregational leaders. Strengthen our combined witness for the sake of the gospel, that all experience your life-giving love. Merciful God,
hear our prayers.
We pray for the universe. All creation teems with life, from the depths of the earth and seas to the skies above. Fill us with awe and reverence for the diversity and preservation of life. Merciful God,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the nations of the world. Topple the dividing walls that separate us from our neighbors. Form us into your beloved community, where diversity of gender, race, language, ability, and ethnic origin is celebrated and affirmed. Merciful God,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit. Be present with all who are lonely and give courage to all who are afraid. Comfort those who live with chronic illness or other sickness. And of course, we especially lift up Susie at this time. And we thank you, Lord, that she was encouraged last night after going through such a terrifying ordeal. And we pray, Lord, that you will bring her to healing and wholeness. And thank you, Lord, for restoring her spirit. Lord, we lift up all who need comfort and healing. We pray for Marge, Beverly, Karen, June, Robert, Edie, Brad, Frida and Larry Nelson. Give them your living water always, merciful God.
Hear our prayer.
And we also pray healing for the Reverend Linda Smith, recovering from a broken ankle and toe, and prayers for Bev Butler, who is recovering at her daughter's home. She is doing better, and the prayers are working. Special prayers for Jared Hoffman, who is hospitalized for medical and mental crisis. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for this congregation, especially those preparing for baptism. Nurture their faith and pour your love into their hearts. Inspire our community by their testimony to God's grace in their lives. Merciful God.
Hear our prayer.
And Lord, we thank you that we have a Savior in Jesus Christ, who is devoted to us beyond our comprehension, who is devoted to us both when we're doing good and we're doing less than good. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for all of the churches in the greater Winlock area. May they be touched by your love, compassion, and forgiveness, and may they be inspired, so devoted to you that they bring your light to all they meet. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And now we lift up the prayers of your people at this time.
Continued prayers for Katie Finney. It looks like maybe her cancer has spread to her brain. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Pray for the family of Jeannie Emmeninger. They couldn't get her heart restarted after surgery. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for Maria San and her husband, who is in the hospital. He's very sick, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. And Lord, we thank you for the leadership of this church. We thank you for our council. Thank you, Lord, for taking care of our administrative needs during time of Susie's illness and recovery. Thank you, Lord, for looking out, for being devoted to St. Paul's and Winlock, and for being a very present help in our very midst. Lord, in your mercy. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole church. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And now the Lord be with all of you always.
And also with you.
Share the peace with a wave or a fist bump or whatever you do. The peace of the Lord. You may be seated, and at this time we share generously the blessings that God shares with us. We share our offering. Sure, grateful for your every Sunday taking care of the offering. Now you're hired. We continue now as the choir is going to share their anthem. It was so neat hearing you and the plucking on the guitar when we got here this morning. It sounded really good. So we hear the choir. Thank you, Kim.